just beginning. The pen's in my hand, the ending's unplanned. Staring at the blank page before you, open up the dirty window, let the sun illuminate the words that you could not find. Reaching for something in the distance, so close you could almost taste it. Release your inhibitions, feel the rain on your skin. No one else can feel it for you, only you can let it in. No one else, no one else could speak the words on your lips. Drench yourself in words unspoken. Lift your arms wide open. Today is where your book begins. The rest is still unwritten. I break tradition. Sometimes my tries are outside the lines. We've been conditioned to not make mistakes, but I can't live that way. Staring at the blank page before you, open up the dirty window, let the sun illuminate the words that you could not find. Reaching for something in the distance, so close you could almost taste it. Release your inhibitions, feel the rain on your skin. No one else can feel it for you, only you can let it in. No one else, no one else could speak the words on your lips. Drench yourself in words unspoken. Live your life with arms wide open. Today is where your book begins. The rest is still unwritten. Before you open up the dirty window, let the sun illuminate the words that you could not find. Reaching for something in the distance, so close you can almost taste it. Release your inhibitions, feel the rain on your skin. No one else can feel it for you, only you can let it in. No one else, no one else could speak the words on your lips. Drench yourself in words unspoken. Live your life with arms wide open. Today is where your book begins. Feel the rain on your skin. No one else can feel it for you, only you can let it in. No one else, no one else can speak the words on your lips. Drench yourself in words unspoken. Live your life with arms wide open. Today is where your book begins. The rest is still unwritten.
Thank you. I love that song on so many levels. I love feeling the rain on your skin. How often do we do that? All right, so it is my privilege to introduce our speaker today, our guest speaker. One of my very first classes ever with CSL Seattle was with Reverend Eric Odell. So Reverend Eric Odell was the music ministry director here at CSL Seattle for 14 years, from 1995 to 2009. He served the community also as a practitioner, and his Friday night talent shows at CBAC are legendary, for those of you that have been. In 2009, he co-founded Amazing Grace Spiritual Center in Ballard with Reverend Colette Mercier, and then He retired from Amazing Grace just a few years ago in 2020, and he has been serving as the transitioning minister at Genesis Spiritual Center in Renton. He's also a guest speaker at Unity of Bellevue, Seattle Unity, CSL Rogue Valley in Medford, and it is my honor to introduce to you Reverend Eric O'Dell.
Thank you. Yay! It's really, really great to be here. Hi to everybody at home, and it's great to be with people that I love. I remember I saw Arnie Marcus in the back there beaming at me, and guys up there in the balcony. He's so great. And it's always wonderful to have time with Chava because she's the real thing. You know, when I was music director, you get to really experience a lot of different musicians. And there are musicians who sing well or play well, meaning they sing notes well and they play notes well. And then there are people who have soul, and the music is the means through which their soul feeds the world. And Chava is in that capacity. She's in that category. You're the real deal. I'm not just buttering you up for no good reason. I love you. All right. Now, to my talk. One of the first things that you learn in Science of Mind is something that I call the Red Jeep Principle. And the way it works is, if you have decided that you want a red Jeep, all of a sudden, everywhere you go, all you see are red Jeeps. Now, it's an aspect of this formal thing called the law of mental equivalence, which sounds like a lot of jargon. I like to call it the red Jeep principle. So when I was invited to speak here, and the topic was recreation, and I came up with this talk title, Games People Play, all of a sudden, my attention is on all the game playing that goes on, all the games that I play, and how games are like, and I was like, oh, well, duh, human beings are hardwired to play games, and to play, and to have fun, and our brains have evolved to solve problems, or we might say to solve puzzles. Okay? And hence our collective compulsion is to play games. Now, stick with me because I'm going somewhere spiritual, but not yet. Okay. So it starts in infancy and with patty cake and those toy mobiles. We hang over the baby's crib and we play choo-choo train and airplane to get the baby to eat. How many people have done that? Right? You know what I'm talking about. And babies and toddlers love to play peekaboo. It's like this endlessly fascinating game. And as an adult, I've gotten to play it on the airplane with kids who sit in the seat behind me. Pop up, pop down. They can't get enough of it. Hopscotch, tag, hide and seek, doctor, cops and robbers, Barbie, hello. Okay, G.I. Joe's, board games, dodgeball, Rover, Red Rover, telephone, charades. And once we become teenagers, we love to play spin the bottle. And the age-old game, talk your parents into the latest possible curfew. Or the game, how to get in the house late without getting caught. Right? These are games. And so games and game playing follows us all our lives. When I retired from full-time ministry in 2020, the first week, I just was in heaven. I'm free. I'm free. I never have to have a full-time job ever again. And it was great for a week. 1 week. And then I was like, oh my God, who am I now? You know how a caterpillar builds a cocoon and then dissolves in the cocoon? I was like, what's in the cocoon dissolved but with no shell. That's what it felt like. Because I did not know who I was. I was raised middle class, and all of my jobs had very acceptable middle class titles. So I had an acceptable identity, right? And now I had no identity because I had no job title. And it was very uncomfortable. Very. But I had two really good friends who are ministers and knew what they were talking about. And one was Edwin Gaines and one was Linda Rapond. And they both said, do nothing for 40 days. You need your 40 days in the desert. Don't make any decisions. Just be. And I was like, okay. And my 40 days turned out to be 60 days. And my husband and I went to on a trip to Las Vegas, a road trip to Las Vegas. And the last day, just before we were going to leave, it came to me, the cello. And I came home and I rented a cello and I practiced every day and I never looked back. But in between, during that 60 days, I was like, well, what do, because I'd been exposed to new thought, duh, for like a couple of decades and I had some skills. And so I thought, well, you know, what do I want to do? What do I want to do now? If I'm financially free and I have time. And I said, all I want to do is play and learn. And I realized that's what we expect of children. You know, in a normal childhood, you don't expect the kid to be the breadwinner or have a job. Their job is to play and learn. And so I said, oh, that's what my retirement's going to be, second childhood. Right? So that's what I'm doing. That's my second childhood. It's not just human beings that love to play. We got a new cat, and she's adorable, and now she wakes me up every morning at 5 a.m. And we have to go to the living room, and she gets 10 to 15 minutes of chasing the birdie on the wire. And every morning it's like the first morning of creation. She's just like the birdie on the wire until she stops panting, and then I get to go upstairs and read the paper. And here I read the paper every morning, and there's two sections, except for Sunday. There's two sections. The first section is news and opinion, but what is the second section? Sports. Cartoons, crossword puzzle, jumble, Scrabble, Ken, word game, game. That's half of the paper. That's got to tell you something. And who besides me is hooked on Wordle? You know that Wordle was invented by a couple and they sold it to the New York Times for $1 million? Hello. It's five letter word game, and they made $1 million. Hallelujah! And who plays New York Times Spelling Bee? Totally hooked. Completely hooked. Okay. The first video game was made in 1958 and was very popular with the people who were inventing that. But the first popular video game was in 72, and today the gaming market industry is $248 billion a year. $248 billion a year, and employs 500,000 people in the United States alone. You may be saying to yourself, okay, I'm not really into that. I'm not into video games or sports or crossword puzzles, but do you like murder mysteries? That's solving a puzzle. And how about spy stories? And how about crime procedurals? How many people watch Law and Order? Hello, come on. The brain is wired to solve riddles. Even romance novels and rom-coms are built around the puzzle of whether the lovers will get together in the end. So even if you don't like any of the rest of it, how many read romance novels like rom-coms? And the thing that I notice is, at the end of the story, when the couple gets together, now I don't care about them. Because now there's no problem. Right? How many people saw that movie, The Graduate, with Dustin Hoffman? okay? He spends the whole movie chasing after the girl. He drags her out of her own wedding to get her, and they get on the bus, and then they sit there and they have nothing to say to each other. If you include professional sports, TV game shows, monster truck rallies, casinos, bingo halls, state lotteries, racetrack and online betting, bowling rinks, golf courses, and all the rest of it, it starts to feel like that's all we do is play games. Great spiritual teachers and traditions have used the metaphor of games to describe the whole of life. So it's not completely separate from this project of spirituality. In Hinduism, the Sanskrit word lila, L-I-L-A, means divine play, or it's the notion that all of creation is a game that the Atman or the Oversoul is playing. And in New Thought, we say the spirit is the supreme and sublime. Well, you may not say that, but I say that, and I've heard other people say it, that the spirit is the supreme and sublime artist which, seeking to know itself, created the 10,000 things. Isn't that great? I love that. Oh, and by the way, here's a freebie I didn't put in the first service. I had this, it just popped in my head. I have to tell you this. It really has nothing to do with this, but it's kind of there. A few years ago, this young guy contacted me, and he was in a Christian theological school. And he was going around the country in the summer on a project interviewing ministers from many different traditions, just for his own edification, and he wanted to interview a religious science minister. And so we talked, and I blew his mind wide open. And you know, often we struggle in some ways with saying, what is New Thought? You know, who are we? How do we describe it? And I said, we are a Genesis 1 people in a Genesis 2 world. Okay, Genesis 1 is the story of evolution. God is the voice that speaks into the void, sound familiar, and says, let there be light and let there be. And we teach that we are that voice that speaks into the void and says, let there be. And then God created the light and the dark and the water and the earth and the planets and then the plants and then the animals and then the people. Sound familiar? It's called evolution. And every day, and God said it was. Hello, and God said it was.
Good.
And what do we say? That life is?
Good.
That we are?
Good.
That all is?
Good.
Okay. So, and he was like, but what about all the problems in the world? And I said, either you believe that God's in charge or you don't. And he was just like, bung, bung. I could just see his brain going like this. Anyway, I digress. Back to my talk. So if somebody asks you, what is New Thought? Say, we are a Genesis 1 people in a Genesis 2 world. Because Genesis 2 is the snake and Eve is evil and we're thrown out of, you know, we're thrown out of the Garden of Eden and all that. And I'm sure it's got great metaphors and great teaching, but I like Genesis 1. Okay, so Mother Teresa has this poem where she throws out all these metaphors for what life is. And I'm not going to go through the whole poem, but some of the lines are, life is a dream, realize it. Life is an adventure, dare it. Life is a song, sing it. And life is a game, play it. So even she, you know, Mother Teresa, seriousness itself, is like, life is a game, play it. Okay. If we extend the metaphor to all life, there's an entire realm of human activity that also you can look at as a game. And this is the world of psychological games. And in 1964, Dr. Eric Byrne published this book called Games People Play. And that's where the title of my talk came from. And these are psychological games. Now, he was really outlining transactional analysis. And that is boring to me, and so we're not going there. But he is onto something when he talks about the games we play. So one of the games we play is sibling rivalry, okay? So it's a game, And what the children are doing is competing with each other to get their parents' love and attention. And I know none of you did any of that, but my brother and I totally did that. And my older brother tried to get their attention by causing a lot of trouble. Starting in kindergarten, he found a can of black paint in the garage and then went out and painted the sides of all the cars on the street. And it went from there. And I was a very goody two-shoes. And so we were the opposite. We were both trying to get our parents' attention in opposite ways. Does that sound familiar? Okay, that's one game. That's a game. Another one is victim, persecutor, rescuer. That's a game. It's a cycle. It has rules. People play through that game. And then a third one is, why do you make me hit you? That's a game that abusers play. And everything that I do to you is your fault. That's a game. And all those kinds of games are outlined in this book, or many of them, the games people play. And it's never gone out of print. My talk today, I just really have three points. So I'm just going to do them. And then later when people ask you, what did he talk about, you'll be able to say. So everybody take a deep breath, wake up, and pay attention. The first point is we're hardwired to play games. The second point is, if you are not succeeding in any area or issue of your life, maybe it's time to look at it as a game and change the rules of the game that you are playing. And if that doesn't work, my third point is, play a different game. Hello. Okay? We play games. There's some area of your life that isn't great or isn't what you want it to be. Think of it as a game. What are the rules of the game? Because, you know, in sibling rivalry, there's a goal. All these games that people play, these psychological games, they have a motivation, like any game. You know, football, get the ball to the end zone, right? Every game has a, you know, charades, get the title of the film. Every game has a goal, has some way to win, unless you're playing a game where the rule of the game is nobody wins. Think about it. Okay, and if you can't change the rules of the game, then change the game. Okay, that's my talk in a nutshell. Now I'm going to give you some examples and tell you some stories. So, yay! Okay. Katharine Hepburn famously said, if you play by all the rules, you miss all the fun. And what she means is, if you play by all the rules that people give you or that you inherit, you will miss all the fun that is for you. Make sense? And how many people have tried to do it by other people's rules? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Parents have this delusion that they own you. No, they exist to serve you and create that future that they will never see. That's their job. So, two lightweight examples of what I mean by changing the rules. So, I had the privilege when I was part of the staff here of doing 14 summer camps. And one of the gifts that I got out of summer camp was learning to play Mexican train dominoes. And it was great. And when you play Mexican train dominoes, there are these little plastic trains that you use, and they tell other people whether they can play on your train or not. And one year, the set didn't have the little trains, and so we started putting paper napkins on our heads instead. And one gal started, she knew how to fold the paper napkins into all these different shaped hats. And so then we started wearing these paper hats. And then I became part of a gang that we call our Mexican Train Domino's Posse, and Allison is in it, she's here today. And we evolved into wearing silly hats. So we have some hats to model for you, if we could have our hat models come up. So starting on this end, we've got the cooked turkey hat, very lovely. We've got the goat horns. I don't know what to call this, the thingy. This is the medieval Pope hat. This is a hat, a crown that I often wear with a ratty bathrobe so I look like a community, a theater production of King Lear. And then these are bunny ears, and this is the Medusa hat. So let's... Thank you, guys. You may be seated. And so that's an example. The little plastic trains are stupid and boring, and I hate them, but we play with silly hats, and it's really great. That's an example of changing the rules, right? Now, another game changer is baseball was invented in 1836, and it's 184 years old, and Major League Baseball just went through a change of the rules. And that there's a reason, and it's that the game, the pace of culture and life has gotten so much faster that people don't like baseball because it's too slow, because it was invented in 1836, and the pace of life was a lot like today. And so they've changed the rules of the game, and a friend of mine just took his son, two sons, to a Mariners game, and he said the game was 2.5 hours instead of 3.5 hours, and they had more fun. So I'm saying to you, if Major League Baseball can change the rules, take a deep breath, let it go. You can change the rules of any game that you are playing because you're a creative being and you get to do that. And you get to change the rules, you get to try changes, and then change again. We had this long debate in the dominoes game about, now what is the exact rule about if we do this thing and blah, blah, blah. We had to go like through it. We have changed the rules of the game too because we have so much fun. And that's what it's all about. You should be, I don't want to say you should be. Some people do love to suffer. Some people came here to suffer. Some people are here for the drama and the martyr's path. And that is great. But that is not me. And you can be having fun in every area and issue of life, really. So here's some examples of people changing the rules about the games they play, psychological games. I know somebody, actually this is a person who changed the game. I know somebody who moved to a fancy community on the water. And this is a community that's into yachting and boating. And they wanted to be a part, they wanted to be part of the in-group. That is a basic human need, anybody who ever went through their teen years. And you needed to be part of the in-group, whether you were or not, you wanted to be. Well, this grown-up person still wanted to be part of the in-group. So what they did was they bought not one, they bought two boats, even though they get terrible seasickness. And then they had to spend their weekends maintaining the boat, throwing up. Because they wanted to be part of the in-group. And finally they wised up and they thought, well, what is true for me? And how else could I be part of this community that I've moved to? And they got involved in a service organization, eventually became president of the whatever it is, you know, and sold the boats. You know that a boat is a hole in the water you pour money into, right? So they sold the two boats at a loss, and now they're much happier. Okay, here's another example. A couple came to me, and they were raised in two different cultures, and they had a problem. They had a conflict, and it was big for them and very serious. And this is the conflict. This person was raised in a culture that when you get an invitation and it says 7 o'clock, you show up at 7. And this person was raised in a culture where when you get an invitation and it says 7 o'clock, you do not come at 7. You give the host more time to get ready because in that culture, everybody's late. And you never want to be the first people to show up at the party. And so they would have huge fights about whether they're going to be on time or not. So they came to me with this problem, and I said, well, how about this? If this person gets the invite, then they say we go on time. And if this person gets the invite, they say we go late. And if the couple gets the invite, they call the host and ask them what they want. What a concept. Problem solved. Okay? Now, think about it. There's nothing wrong with them. There's nothing wrong with this culture. There's nothing wrong with saying we come on time. There's nothing wrong with saying we don't come on time. But they were like, they were like gonna, you know, it was like, were we gonna stay together over this? And on the outside of the relationship, it sounds utterly ridiculous, but are we not like that? Don't we get into like the toothpaste tube? Who's gonna clean the cat box? Toilet paper, does it go this way? Does it go that way? You know, come on, we're human. All of this happens. Here's another game, and it's I can save you from addiction. I can save you. You keep using, and I'll just nag you. You keep using, and I'll beg you. You keep using, and I'll help you pay for your junk in order to keep nagging you and begging you, okay? I'll be your conscience. I'll be your voice of reason. I'll shame you. I'll be in denial with you. That's the biggest game. I see some people recognizing, I'll be in denial with you. Everybody take a nice deep breath. This is the non-fun part of the talk. It's still fun. And that is why when people are need Al-Anon, and the first rule, the first step for people in Al-Anon, that is the people who are tied to or in a relationship with an addict, the first step is still, I am powerless over alcohol. I am powerless over this person's addiction. And so instead of playing the game, I will save you, you need to save who? That's right. Say it again. So this is a great moment for you to stop for a second and think, well, who am I trying to fix? Is there somebody in your life you're trying to fix? That is such a losing game. I want to give a metaphor. Okay, I'm really getting into it this time around. I'm thinking over my years as a practitioner, and it's so great. It's such a privilege. You learn so much by hearing about people's problems because the brain is wired to try and solve problems. Okay. So I know people who have prosperity issues, and they think that their issue is going to be solved by winning the lottery. So they play the game of playing the lottery. And your odds, I think your odds of winning one of these huge lotteries is like the same odds as if you were to be struck by lightning 11 times in the same spot. That's how good your odds are. And even people who do win the lottery, then because they have no prosperity consciousness, are in debt a year later. Because it's not about the amount of money, it's about the prosperity consciousness, okay? So, that was the reason I tied that to playing a different game. So the game, instead of I will save my life, I will turn around my prosperity experience by winning the lottery, instead of playing that, which is a losing game, play the game of, let me get rid of the false ideas I have about money and prosperity. If you hate rich people, you will not prosper. You will not prosper because the second you come into money, it has to go away because you cannot be in that hated group of people who are rich. And, you know, what is rich? Everybody in this room is in the top 10% of the human race just by being in America and not homeless. We're the rich people already. I hate to upset you, but everybody in this room is actually rich, really rich. I had to say this. I was in Chicago last weekend, and I'm on this boat cruise, and it's an architecture boat cruise, and it's like the gems of architecture right there from the 1800s to today. And I can see all of these buildings. I go into the grocery store and all the food of the whole planet is in one place for me. Crab, lobster, every kind of meat, every kind of vegetable, every kind of fruit. Get it gluten, non-gluten, get it whole wheat, get it, you know, soy milk, oat milk, coconut milk, all this kind of stuff. I mean, we live better than kings and queens of old. They do not have the diet that we have. They don't have the options that we have. They don't have the entertainments that we have. Right? We, you know, was that famous thing from the 70s, TV is we're amusing ourselves to death? We have so much. We are so rich. Everybody take a deep breath. And it's okay, but be grateful. Be grateful. That is a better game than bitching and moaning because it took 2 minutes for the thing to boot up. That's a better game. I, me, mine. Be grateful. Okay. I got a little Old Testament there. Another great game is any person who manages to turn their life story from I'm a victim to I'm an overcomer. That's a great game. That's a much better game. I had a friend, and he was HIV positive, and He told the people he worked for that he was HIV positive. And from the moment he told them, he was like wildly and outrageously discriminated against. Like horribly discriminated against. He'd been climbing the ladder and he got all positive reviews. And suddenly, if he had a nosebleed, they sent him home. You can't come back till you have a doctor's note. The next review was like, well, you did a great job, but we can't give you a promotion because you're going to die of AIDS. Right? And he documented everything and he sued them and he got his salary and health benefits for the rest of his life. And by the way, the company he worked for handled corporate human relations. So we'd been friends for a while, and he constantly told the story of how badly he was treated. He just kept telling the story, you know, and oh my God, and it was so humiliating and so upset, and I had to go through all this stuff. And finally, we were good enough friends where I said to him, I am sick to death of this story, aren't you? And I said, thank God for your boss. Thank God for your boss, because you are free. You have a salary and health for life, and you are outliving. They thought you were going to be dead in 3 months, and it had been like 10 years. So another way to change the game that you're playing is to change the story that you are telling. There's always another way to tell the story. Okay, I'm really almost done. You're so patient. The last thing I want to say is a story about me. Because if I'm up here, I get to talk about myself as well. So this is the story. The examples of marriage that I saw growing up, if I was to describe to you what marriage was, I would say, hell on earth. Now, I wasn't in my parents' marriage, and I wasn't in my other relatives' marriages, and you don't know what's going on. You know what it's like from the inside. But from the outside looking, you know, knockdown, drag-out fights and screaming at each other day after day, it's like, pass. Okay? So I put all of my creative energy into my careers, and it was all about my jobs, and it was great. And then I got hired here to be the music director, and it was the year I was going to be turning 40. And all of a sudden, I found myself thinking, you're not going to be young and cute forever. And I thought, I've done single, maybe I should try married. And I knew I was going to have to, because fortunately I was in a science of mind environment, I knew I was going to have to change my consciousness in order to change my life. Anybody ever heard that? It really works. So this was an opportunity to really confront my false beliefs. And I had two main false beliefs that I really needed to let go of. And one of them was marriage was a trap. That if I got into a committed relationship, my mental equivalent was prison sentence. That's what I thought of marriage. And you, as you can imagine, no matter who I pulled into my life or who I dated, if my belief is that commitment is a prison sentence, there's not going to be a commitment made. Does that make sense? So that was one false belief. And I got the idea that I could be in a relationship that had a lot of space and a lot of freedom. And the other false belief was that my marriage could actually be different than the ones that I had seen. And that was that when I had the thought, oh, my marriage could be different, it was like fireworks. I mean, it sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? That my marriage could be different would be a new idea. But I'd never had that thought. And that was very liberating. And then the third one, and that really clinched it, was that I could put as much creativity into my private life as I was putting it into my work life. And I realized I didn't want to get to the end of my life and have a great career and no great marriage. It just as if I'd gotten to the end of my life and I'd had a great marriage but no great career. I really wanted it all. Helen Gurley Brown. That's who I wanted to be. Only people alive in the 80s would know what I was talking about. Anyway. And so as soon as I got those liberating ideas, I went to a gay men's spiritual retreat. My husband walked in. We looked at each other across a crowded room, and we've been together 28 years. Guy, can we have somebody have the slide? That's us. Thank you, Science of Mind. You can have it. You can own it. You can create it. You can experience it. You can heal it. You can unfold with it. There's no area of life that the spirit cannot do work a miracle. And it has to do with maybe you need to change the rules of the game that you're playing, or you need to play a different game. Because there's a million games. There's a million ways to do it. My first book I was ever given as a New Thought book was The Game of Life and How to Play It by Florence Scovel Shinn. Anyone ever read it? If you haven't read it and you're still wondering what is this thing, it's a little thin book, and it's great because it gives you an idea, and then it gives you all these stories and examples of how it works. And she says that life is a great game of giving and receiving, and that's the truth. In order to win the game of life, know the game that you're playing. Know what is motivating you. And ask yourself, am I playing this game with the rules that are working? Or do I need to change the rules? Or do I need to change the game that I'm playing? Let's pray. If you're comfortable, close your eyes. If your eyes are open, know that what you're seeing is God. And as you are taking this moment to be with your beautiful, glorious self, I invite you to allow your Buddha smile to arise. And to allow yourself for this moment to rest in the spirit. To step off the merry-go-round of your days. To let your brain relax. And let the warmth of your heart fill your whole being. There is a loving and benevolent presence back of all creation.
which is as near to you as your very breath. It is right here, right now. And it is pouring forth for you specifically all the love, all the wisdom, all the forgiveness, all the kindness, all the encouragement, all the intelligence you require to win the game of life. I bless our creativity. I bless this field of infinite possibilities in which we abide. I bless the astounding riches of this life, this realm of absolute miracles that we are calling the 21st century. And I claim for each person here some glorious miracle of liberation, of thought or feeling, such that whatever challenge we are facing, it is evaporated as the divine wisdom shows us a better way. All is well. All is beautiful, and all is well, and so is.